Cock and ball torture, or CBT, is the activity of torturing the male genitalia for sexual pleasure. With just that description alone, you probably already have a vivid idea of what CBT might look like and how one would perform it. However, I think there's more to this ball-busting extravaganza that can be explored here than just our surface-level definition. Let's start with some basic observations we can make about CBT. First of all, it should go without saying that this is a form of BDSM that favors individuals with penises, meaning men, and some trans women. Of course, this is obvious since the cock and ball in cock and ball torture implies that one would need a cock and some balls to inflict the torture upon. Secondly, and what I find to be the most fascinating about this complex subject, is the nature of how this activity is performed. At the heart of CBT, there is a victim, the recipient of the torture, and no mention of anyone else. However, this doesn't necessarily mean it's a solo activity. Cock and ball torture can include as many parties as needed, so long as the requirement of someone's balls being on the receiving end of pain is met. With these two pieces of information, we can now make the following claim. CBT is indiscriminate of gender and is very inclusive when it comes to how many individuals can partake in it. It's this claim that will form the foundation of our analysis and will help us take one step closer to understanding where the pleasure derived from bull charging one's balls with a screwdriver comes from. You see, BDSM is a very complex and broad description of numerous sexual activities that inflict controlled pain onto one or more participants. To the outside observer, it may be difficult to understand why someone would want to do this in the first place. After all, why would you want to get hurt? And, in the context of CBT, why would you want to potentially damage your testicles, one of the most sensitive parts of the male genitalia? These questions, at first blush, are fairly reasonable. Pain is considered a net negative, so why would you want more of it? But I think that viewing something like cock and ball torture in this way is very closed-minded. I think if we look beyond the literal actions taken by the testicle tormentor and look at the underlying motivations behind CBT, we'll find a different answer. Cock and ball torture, at the center of everything, boils down to a victim at the mercy of another person, or a piece of cock-destroying machinery. The key word here being victim. When one CBTs oneself, they have to assume the role of someone who is at the mercy of forces much stronger than they are. These forces prey upon a part of them that is vulnerable, normally covered up from the outside world. Men don't normally walk around with their penises hanging out. Doing so would be punishable by law for public indecency. In the case of trans women, the penis is a remnant of themselves before their transition. It is a part of them that, despite their numerous aesthetic changes, remains the same. It is widely considered as a symbol of manhood, a symbol that potentially challenges the public's perception of them as a woman. Perhaps whipping out one's cock and torturing it is a source of pleasure since it is a form of rebellion to the above reasons. Perhaps by flagrantly chastising that part of oneself that must remain hidden, the subject is figuratively fighting back against the societal norms. If we delve further into cock and ball torture, we may begin to see further evidence that lends credence to these questions. As I stated in my observations, CBT doesn't have to be an act one performs solo. More than one person can participate in it. This means that the symbolism regarding this activity can potentially change. At the bare minimum, let's assume two individuals are partaking in cock and ball torture. There are many combinations that can take place here. For the sake of the argument, let us assume one individual is the subject while the other applies torture to his or her balls. In this scenario, the roles we've given each participant have now established a clear power dynamic. There exists a dominant party and a submissive party. The dominant party has control over the victim's cock and balls, of which whose symbolism we've already established. In this case, instead of one person taking action on his or her own to counter societal perceptions of the penis, now there are two people. Two people who are, in a way, figuratively acting out the emotional struggle one faces while having to walk with a meat stick dangling between their legs. The dominant figure is an oppressive force who restrains the genitals of the subject. All the pain of the people's judgment, their scorn for cock, all represented in one swift, torturous moment. However, that's not all there is to it, is there? Because, despite this reenactment, there is still the aspect that this is all being done for pleasure. So, despite the inherent symbolism, there is still an air of rebellion to this procedure that shines through regardless. And that's what we've been trying to get at this whole time, isn't it? Cock and ball torture is a subversive masterpiece of sexual pleasure. It deconstructs societal expectations of the penis and crosses gender norms to accommodate anyone who wishes to partake in it. So, next time your friend wants to cock and ball torture you, maybe instead of looking at them in disgust, you can see them with the compassion you know they deserve.